My name is Carrie Munvan. I'm with Citizens for Public Justice, and I'm pleased to be with you this evening for the Ottawa Vanier All Candidates Environmental Debate. Je ne répéterai pas tous mes remarques ce soir, mais je voulais vous indiquer que vous êtes libre de poser vos questions en anglais ou en français. And not to worry, I'm not going to repeat everything I say this evening, but I did want to make it clear that everyone here is welcome to ask their questions in either French or English. Just a little bit of housekeeping as we get started. The washrooms are through the door straight behind most of you and down the hall to the right. And we're really glad to be here in this this building. We thank the Unitarian Universal Fellowship of Ottawa for hosting us this evening. And I also want to acknowledge the other organizers of this event, Ecology Ottawa and Citizens for Public Justice. Many thanks to the staff and volunteers who have assisted in the preparation of this event, especially Jorge Soher, who was an instrumental volunteer in getting us all together this evening. Et maintenant, j'aimerais offrir le bienvenue aux cinq candidats pour Ottawa Vanier présents avec nous. Neera Duperin, Green Party of Canada, Parti Vert du Canada. Mona Fortier, Liberal Party of Canada, Parti Libéral du Canada. Emily Thaman, New Democratic Party, Nouveau Parti Démocratique. I just realized I got that wrong. Emily Thaman. Thaman like salmon. John Turmel, Independent and Dépendant. And Christina Wilson, also an independent and indépendant. C'est important aussi de noter que vous avez que nous avons invité Adrian Papara, le candidat du Parti conservateur, mais il a refusé. In terms of process this evening, we will proceed as follows. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to offer their opening remarks, and the rest of the evening will be reserved for questions. The first two questions have been prepared by the organizing committee for this evening, and subsequent questions will be taken from the audience. You will have received an index card coming in. I know a number of questions have already been submitted. If inspiration strikes and you have a question, Stephanie at the back, who's waving the index cards now, has additional cards that you can use to ask your question. And just a reminder that we really do want the focus of this evening's discussion to remain on environmental issues, so please keep your questions in that vein. So again, each candidate will have 2 minutes to respond to each question, and afterwards, when we're wrapping up, everybody will have each of the candidates will have 3 minutes to offer their closing remarks. So with that, I'd like to invite Neera Duperin, the Green Party of Canada, to introduce herself.
Hello, good evening, welcome everyone.
Hello, good evening, welcome everyone. Is that too close? Okay, I'll scroll right there. Je suis Neera Duperin, je suis votre candidate. Pour le Parti Vert dans cette élection partielle. Je vais essayer de me débrouiller en anglais ce soir. Je peux entendre vos questions en français, mais je vais répondre en anglais. I'm a high school teacher. Just to introduce myself a little, I have a 23-year-old son. I was born and raised in Winnipeg, Manitoba. My dad was a middle school science and math and health teacher. And I've lived in Ottawa Vanier. I've lived in Ottawa now for 25 years, in Ottawa Vanier for 15. I taught there, Rideau High School, among others. I raised my son at Manor Park Public School. I joined the Green Party many years ago when I moved down to Ottawa South. And I joined because I've always believed that citizens need to take an active role in our democracy to keep it vibrant, especially under the previous regime. We needed to step up, and I did, to do my little part. The Green Party offers, as far as I can see, looking at all the alternatives, the most long-term, comprehensive, foundational thinking around how we're supposed to live on this planet. We share this planet the way we share the room. We have to be stewards, we have to conduct ourselves as good guests on Mother Earth, and we don't do a very good job of that. We could take a lot of lessons from the first peoples of this country, and we can't have to do more than pay lip service to, I'm not saying we did that this evening, but often it's become axiomatic to start gatherings with, we honor and recognize that we're on Algonquin land. If we are, and really honor that, we have to walk the talk, and we have to conduct ourselves as the peoples who lived here for 10,000 years without doing 1% of the destruction that we've done since we've been here.
Thank
we
you.
Need some serious changes. Thank you.
And now Mona Forti from the Liberal Party of Canada.
Merci, thank you. Ottawa Vanier, c'est chez nous. It is where I was born, where I studied, where I opened my first business, and where I raised my family. I am Mona Fortier, a mother, a local businesswoman, a University of Ottawa graduate, a community leader, and a progressive liberal. Ottawa Vanier est une circonscription remplie de petites entreprises locales et une circonscription qui abrite certaines des institutions publiques les plus importantes du Canada et un endroit que je suis fière d'appeler ma communauté. Ottawa Vanier's inclusive neighborhoods are reflective of our collective understanding that we are stronger together. I am a builder and a collaborator and have worked with our school boards, our hospital, our nonprofit organizations, and business community. We must work harder and faster, but we must do so in a measured and evidence-based manner. We must work to make sure that our economy and environment work in harmony, respecting the pristine nature of waterways and forests, while ensuring that our daughters and sons have the skills to compete. We cannot turn environmental protection into a partisan issue. Protecting our environment means investing in the technologies of tomorrow while working with businesses to ensure employees' rights are respected and considered as we move toward a green economy. This means putting an ambitious price on carbon while allowing provinces the flexibility to implement it in a flexible and predictable manner. Avec votre aide et votre soutien, j'ai hâte de travailler avec lui pour bâtir un avenir meilleur pour nous tous. I am running to be your next member of parliament because I believe that I have the skills, the experience, and leadership to help our communities prosper in a 21st economy century. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Emily Tannen?
Thank you.
Hello.
Hi, I'm Emily Tammen. I'm your NDP candidate, and it's my great pleasure to be here with you this evening. Je suis heureuse d'être ici avec vous pour exposer pourquoi j'ai décidé de me présenter dans Ottawa Vanier. Je me présente car je crois que notre gouvernement a le devoir de travailler avec nos communautés pour bâtir une société plus inclusive et plus équitable. Je crois également qu'il a le devoir de mettre en place un plan concret pour lutter contre les changements climatiques et amorcer un virage vert ici au Canada. In the last election, our Prime Minister talked about being a champion for the environment. Since then, he's maintained Harper's emissions targets, approved the Trans Mountain Pipeline, celebrated Trump's approval of Keystone, and has cut $1.25 billion from funds that were promised for the fight against climate change. Les libéraux vont vous dire que l'économie et l'environnement vont de pair. Mais c'est plus facile à dire qu'à faire. Après tout, ils approuvent des projets d'oléoduc sans savoir leurs impacts sur nos émissions. Sadly, promising one thing and delivering another is becoming far too common for our Prime Minister. The reality is, if we don't strengthen the progressive opposition in the House of Commons, our government will continue to back away from the commitments they made to us in the last election. And that's where I come in. As a former federal prosecutor who took on environmental offenders, I know firsthand the importance of both strong environmental protections and robust mechanisms needed to enforce them. I'm committed to working with all levels of government and across party lines to make sure that our fight against climate change is more than just words. Je suis prête à me joindre à l'opposition progressiste pour que le gouvernement demeure fidèle à leurs promesses. If you elect me, I will hold the government to the commitments they've made and truly represent the needs of all the people of our riding. Merci et bon débat.
Thank you. And next, John Turmel, independent, indépendant.
Thank you. Back in the 80s and 90s and 2000s, I ran in every election I could have, my simple Johnny engineer. And this is my 91st, so far unsuccessful, election going on. And you have to wonder, why would I keep doing that? The national debt. This is the national debt, and I got a share of it. Gee, you too. Now you'll notice that up until a certain year was always around under 20 billion through most of our history. Then suddenly it started to explode. 1974, what happened? Guess what? Ontario, this is Ontario's provincial debt. Almost nothing through most of our history, then suddenly, boom, starts to grow. 1974, what happened? Quebec, most of history, nothing. Suddenly it starts to grow. 1974, what happened? And if you think it's just Canada, here's France. And they had pretty well nothing until 1974. Well, what happened in 1974? Well, if you want to know, I'm not telling you. You got to go to my website, smartestmanonearth.ca, because I know and you don't. And I don't even have to be smartestmanonearth.ca to make that point. But this graph also shows how much interest we've paid, us old enough to be, since 1974. And that means that if they hadn't done whatever it is they did in 1974, they wouldn't have to tax us $70,000 each, those of us who've been part of society since 1974. Right? The gray hairs here? So, your debt service, you were taxed 70 grand over your lifetime that could be in your bank account, but instead is in some banker's account because something happened in 1974. And to find out what happened, you got to go to smartestmanonearth.ca.
And last but not least, Christina Wilson, independent.
Hi everybody, I'm Christina Wilson.
I'm running for Member of Parliament. Is
it working? Since February 12th, I've been a politician. And let me tell you, it's really hard, and I really want to thank everybody here, because I never realized really, you know, just everything that you have to do, the energy that you have to put out there just for everybody. So thank you. And so I'm running as an independent. That means I have no party backing me. So I don't have to stick to policies and like liberal constitutions, things like that. So I'm going to be open to everybody's views. And you can ask me questions. It's been really great. Since the 12th, people have been calling me at home and like asking me questions of where I stand and telling me like what's important to them. So I really like to continue this if I'm elected on April 3rd. And definitely, sorry, the environment is like a huge thing. If I had to triage every issue in this world, I would send the environment to the ICU like stat. I think it's the number one thing that affects everybody, no matter who you are, how much money you make. It affects everybody's health, our bodies, our homes, pretty much everything, the economy, politics. So definitely I would start there, and I want to thank everybody here for making it a priority in our lives. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Thank you to everybody. We're now going to head straight into the questions, and just a reminder that the first person to respond will be Mona. La première question, c'est certains d'entre vous ont récemment visité le marché B et ont discuté comment le marché peut devenir un espace public de classe mondiale dans le cœur de notre ville. En plus, la rue Montréal s'est revitalisée et nous avons l'opportunité de créer une rue complète et un modèle pour le transport actif traversant la rue Montréal jusqu'au marché B vers le rideau. Une vraie rue principale au cœur de notre communauté. Si vous êtes élu, allez-vous promouvoir le financement fédéral correspondant aux promesses de la ville et de la province vers 9 millions de dollars pour la première phase du plan de revitalisation du marché paille? Et quelle est votre vision pour l'avenir de la rue Montréal? I'm going to repeat the question in English. Some of you recently toured the Byward Market and discussed how it can become a truly world-class public space at the heart of our city. In addition, Montreal Road is also being revitalized, and we have the opportunity to create a complete street and a model for active transportation from Montreal Road through Rideau to the market, a true main street of our community. If elected, will you champion federal funding matching city and provincial pledges towards the $9 million for the first phase of Ottawa's Byward Market Revitalization Plan? And what is your vision for the future of Montreal Road? Mona, you're up first.
Do you prefer if we stand up? There you go. Perfect. Alors, je vais commencer en français parce que la question a commencé en français. Je pense qu'au cours des dernières semaines, nous avons eu l'occasion de rencontrer les leaders du projet du marché bail et compris plus clairement les besoins. Et je pense que c'est nécessaire que l'on travaille sur le projet de collaboration qu'il y a avec la ville, la province. Et si je suis élue, j'espère pouvoir travailler très fort pour aller chercher le financement nécessaire pour compléter le 9 millions nécessaire pour revitaliser le marché bail. I also believe that this great example of what has been done with the market, the working with the leaders, the association, the city of Ottawa and the province is a great example of what we should continue to do to revitalize Montreal Road. And if and when I'm elected, I hope to be able to work with the City of Ottawa's project in 2018 to revitalize Montreal Road and bring more businesses on Montreal Road and change the face of Montreal Road. We have a lot of work to do. I'm a collaborator, I'm a negotiator, I'm ready to work and help hopefully bring businesses to create their space on Montreal Road and also make sure that it is a complete street so we can have access to bikes, bike lanes, transit, walkability, and also car traffic. So I'm committed to work on these two projects, and I think that are a great example of how we can bring to Ottawa Vanier better roads and better communities. Thank you.
I'm just going to try without the mic, if that's okay. Can you hear me better?
I don't know which mic you're going to use.
That's okay. No, that it wasn't a criticism. But...
So if you're using that mic, I think we're okay. All doesn't bother you.
Okay, perfect. So I had the pleasure of attending the Byward Market open house. I guess it was more of a tour that we were provided. As a former resident of the Byward Market myself, I very much appreciate the effort that's been made into, that's been put into really transforming the market into, you know, the jewel in Ottawa's crown that it is and should be. One thing that's always been very striking for me is that when you come from up by the U.S. Embassy and you look down to the market, say you're coming from the hotels downtown, you essentially see cars parked on the street. You see a parking tower and cars. And so the idea to look into the possibility of removing street parking and finding alternative parking arrangements to really make the Byward Market feel like a place where pedestrians want to be, I think is something that's really exciting. The opportunity for it to really function as a public square, I think is something that will really enhance its value, not only to residents, tourists, but also for all of us in the surrounding areas. J'ai aussi eu la chance d'être présente pour le open house sur le revitalisation. J'ai tellement de difficultés avec ce mot revitalisation du chemin Montréal et absolument des rues complètes avec tout ce qu'ils apportent, non seulement pour que le chemin Montréal devienne plus une destination où on veut vraiment être, marcher en bicyclette aussi. Ça va, je pense, vraiment amener des opportunités économiques et puis ça va améliorer la qualité de vie pour tout le monde dans le quartier. Alors oui, j'appuie, je vais faire tout ce que je peux pour amener les fonds fédéraux pour ces deux projets parce que je pense qu'ils vont être vraiment importants pour notre ville et notre communauté. Merci.
Et pourquoi est-ce qu'il n'y a pas assez d'investissement pour le marché de chemin Montréal? Intérêt. Quand on dépense 30-40 milliards par année sur l'intérêt en premier, il y en manque. Et c'est pour ça qu'il n'y en a pas assez. Il faut toujours payer les banquiers leur intérêt en premier à cause de 1974, cette maudite année-là. Donc, I'll pay my tax for army and police to handle strife. I'll pay my tax for doctors, nurses who protect my life. I'll pay my tax for all engaged repairing road and sewer, the Marché and Montreal Road. I'll even pay my tax for social servants helping out the poor. I'll even pay my tax for bureaucrats with no regret. I only object to paying tax for interest on debt. Get it? If I get something for my tax money, no problem. But money's time is not human useful time. And if you want to give me human useful time, great. But trying to get me to pay for money's time, not great. So that's basically it. If you're not wasting the money on interest, paying only for human time, well, you're not going to run short, and you can have nicer roads and nicer markets.
Okay, so Byward Market got like a little facelift. I went down there, and I'm sure you guys can agree, there's still a lot of problems there. Homeless people everywhere. There's three homeless shelters. And I'm just wondering, like, when the LRT is done and there's a lovely warm space underneath, I wonder if everybody's just going to go under there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm not sure if, like, just facelifts for communities are going to work, but maybe, you know, social things like, you know, having people learn how to, live, you know, cook, cleaning, just day-to-day things, making schedules for yourself, just things like that, getting back to really learning how to live again. And that goes for everybody, like homeless and everybody that lives in Rockcliffe also. I'm sure we could all, no, he's giving me the no. Anyway, okay, so Montreal Road is going to get a facelift too, and I'm wondering the same thing here. So it's great that we can just throw money on it and, you know, construct a beautiful place, but still, like, I always think of the people, and I hope that maybe some of that money would go towards the people and actually changing our lives.
Is it okay if I sit? Is that all right? Okay, thank you. When I travel around, and we've all traveled, when we go to places like Mexico or...
You talk too close.
I'm too close. Okay, sorry. There we go. What we see in many places that are considered developing economies as opposed to ours is people gathering in spaces, public spaces, plazas, public squares. There's a real vibrant community feel. People walk in the evening, people walk in the morning. And one of the main things that makes that possible is there aren't cars, buses, trucks whizzing by. So the first thing we have to do is get the cars and the parking problem removed from Montreal, Rideau Street. And hopefully the LRT is addressing that. And improve public transportation, good bicycle lanes, good pedestrian walkways, sidewalks that are in good repair for people. Perhaps in wheelchairs or with canes or small children. All of that needs to be attended to make sure that in terms of traffic and circulation of people, people can walk safely and bike safely. We also need to support small business. We need to give the tax credits and the support for small businesses so that that strip doesn't turn into a strip of chain restaurants, for example. And I remember when I used to go down to Montreal Road and the first time I saw the Harvey's open up there, thinking, and that was quite a few years ago, thinking, oh my goodness, is Montreal Road going to turn into a strip like something out in Orleans or Canada, or is it going to retain that local flavor that, say, Beechwood Avenue has, or the Glebe has? That takes commitment. The Green Party proposes always to collaborate among all levels of government. We propose in our platform, if you ever take a look, if you ever have a few minutes, a permanent structure called the Council of Canadian Governments, which would make sure that there's a permanent structure for federal, provincial, municipal, territorial, and Indigenous leadership to work together throughout the year, meeting 3, 4, 6 times a year as necessary to make sure that there's a structure in place for working among different jurisdictions so that we do collaborate. And for sure, we would support a one-third, one-third, one-third funding model for the revitalization of Montreal Road. Thank you.
And now for question number 2. If built, TransCanada's Energy East pipeline would be the largest pipeline project in North America. The proposed project would transport over 1 million barrels of oil and tar sands bitumen every day through Ottawa and many of the waterways the city depends on for its drinking water. Independent engineering consulting firm Savaria has assessed that if Energy East ruptured on either the Rideau or Mississippi rivers, anywhere from 2 to 23 million liters or more of oil would be spilled and would enter our drinking water, threatening our health and safety. Because of this, if elected, would you oppose the Energy East pipeline? Up first is Emily.
I can do it. Yes, absolutely. I mean, our Prime Minister promised us that there would be no pipelines approved under the current faulty conflict of interest written National Energy Board process. The environmental regulations that govern the process are not robust enough to satisfy us, even come close to satisfying us, that it would be in the public interest to proceed with Energy East. If we were to have a spill as described, this is not something that a couple of squirts of palm olive are going to take care of. I mean, we are talking about bitumen that, if spilled into our waterways, could be there for a very, very long time. We do not have the capacity to clean up a spill like that, and I can't even fathom what that would mean for our city. And I would urge the government to do the work that they said they were going to do in reforming the National Energy Board, reforming the regulations that govern the approval process for a project like this. But I don't see, under the current system, and I have a hard time imagining a system that could possibly be put in place that would satisfy us in our community, that we would be prepared to take a risk like that. It would take the government making a very strong case based on evidence, not rhetoric. And I just don't see that happening, and this is certainly something that I would not be prepared to support. Thank you.
Yes, and until the evidence comes out, I have to agree.
I was just going to say that I'm not even sure why we're debating that. Like, that would be awful, and we're not going that way anymore into the future. We want to be progressive. We're going into... Is it my turn? Sorry, you're getting... we're progressing into, renewable energies, wind, thermal, solar. There's no way that we should even be talking about oil, But thanks to whoever brought it up.
I like oil.
Why?
Because it doesn't cause global warming.
As long as you don't burn it.
The sun does.
All right, I'll give you that for now, John, because you didn't take any time on that answer. So, but we're back to the moment. Here and now, sorry.
The Green Party is the only party that unequivocally opposes Energy East, the Energy East pipeline. We are not in favor of any oil pipeline expansion, but definitely not for Energy East. The Canadian pipelines and tankers are not shipping oil; they're shipping diluted bitumen, otherwise known as dilbit. It combines raw solid bitumen with toxic fossil fuel condensates. We have no real data to show how that behaves in the open ocean. We do know that it's next to impossible to clean up. Early indicators show that the dilbit, if leaked, will sink to the bottom of the ocean floor. It could devastate fishery and tourism sectors across pipeline routes. It is planned to cross under the Ottawa River, I understand, near Kempville. A spill there would affect the water quality and the river ecosystem, as well as land ecosystems in its path, and it is next to impossible to clean up. There are currently four major pipeline proposals, and Kinder Morgan's Trans Mountain, Energy East, Keystone, which Trump just approved, and Enbridge's Line 3. We do need to manage a transition from fossil fuel to clean energy. We also support a reasoned approach to oil sands. We say no to risky pipelines. And we believe that if we're going to develop anything in the tar sands, we should be refining it here at home, which will create jobs and not create the dangers and risks associated with transporting it across the country. We need a long-term energy strategy. We need a reformed environmental review process. We don't have any of that now. We have a flip-flopping back and forth. And on the part of the other parties, I'll just say that even Tom Mulcair has called Energy East a win-win-win. It is not a win-win-win. It's a lose-lose-lose for our area. And we need to bring it up. We need to give it a higher profile in our region. Thank you.
Thank you.
I should answer first. I'm sure people want to hear me now. Sorry, I feel really under the weather, so please excuse myself if I feel sometime under a little bit of tiredness. But this is a really important question, and I know it's a very passionate question in our riding. Honestly, I'm also trying to make a decision on what is best, and I'm worried because what if we choose the train to push our products and something happens like Lac Mégantic? That is very worrisome. What will be the best way to move our products at this time? Is Energy East the right one? And where I applaud our government is the fact that we've decided to review, to take the process back to zero and start reviewing this with the National Energy Board that will look at it with experts and will bring back recommendations to government so we can make a decision. And that I applaud, that we are re-examining this project. When we'll receive the recommendations, I'm hoping that it will be something that will support a safe, secure way to push the products in if Energy East is a good way. So what I would like to invite the members of Ottawa Vanier is to participate to those consultations. Say what you feel, say what you think, because we are in that process, and I think that this consultation will give us the right information to make a responsible decision. So I invite you to participate to this process. Thank you.
Thank you, Melanie. My apologies for losing track of where we were at. So the first question then from the audience is, pouvez-vous élaborer sur la question des enjeux environnementaux sur King Edward et les camions? Quelles seront vos solutions? Could you please elaborate on the question of environmental issues on King Edward, especially the trucks? What are your solutions? And John, you're up first.
All right, I gotta point out how smart Argentinians are and how stupid we are. Don't get mad. In the 80s, when Argentina was broke and they were gonna lay everybody off, the union said, sorry, no layoffs. You want to bring your bond to New York to get bills, pay us tax on it with interest? We'll take $1 peso bonds, as long as we can use them for hydro, taxes, medical, and licenses. So, six Argentinian provinces started printing provincial bonds. See, lady,
fools.
I'm going to get to it. That's the punchline, but you're not going to get it, will you? If you miss the premise, you miss the punchline. You think I don't have a punchline? Anyway, Argentinian unions said no layoffs, we'll take bond bucks. And there were no layoffs, and they went to full employment. And they paid off all their foreign national debt, and they had a lot of money. So, King Edward, if Argentinians could print up enough bonds to put everybody to work, Why couldn't we have 3-4 shifts of guys working on the equipment and instead of having guys go home and leaving the equipment idle? Right now, the only excuse you got for one shift instead of 5 is not enough money, right? And yet the Argentinians had these bond bucks that they could use for hydro, Ontario Hydro, your taxes, your medical, your licenses. Who wouldn't take a piece of paper that pays all that? And that's how they could have 5 shifts working on the roads, and you guys are proud to get out 1, maybe.
How much money would it take for you to work at 3 a.m. in the cold?
Lady, if you offer me a bonus, a lot of guys will do it. Besides, some of us are real men.
I worked for Trace for 15 years, and I taught at the college in the carpentry program. Don't talk to me about real men.
Sounds like you never met any.
Okay, so yeah, I've been a resident of Ottawa pretty much my whole life, and
too close.
Yes. Okay. Yes, I've seen these trucks going downtown, and I'm wondering, why is it even our problem? Shouldn't the corporations, the people who are delivering all these products, could they not just look at a map and go somewhere else
around
the city and not right inside the heart of Ottawa? Like, why don't we just say no? That's my...
It's cheaper, right? It's cheaper.
Yeah, well, now's the time that we have to make the corporations accountable for stuff. Like, you know, stop coming to us for the spending to get your products from coast to coast.
First, save them the interest, and then maybe.
No interest. Yeah. Okay. Well, anyway, so that's what I'm saying is it's not our problem at all. It's the corporations. They have CEOs that this is their job to figure out all this stuff. Really.
Thank you. All right, Mira.
Okay, so that King Edward truck tunnel, when I got involved in this two years ago in the 2015 election, I learned that this problem's been around since 1965. So it's one of those things that seems that just keeps getting shelved to the bottom of the priority list. I understand that there is a proposal now before the city council create an underground tunnel from King Edward down to the 417, crossing, getting the trucks to the 417 near the old baseball stadium at Coventry Road. If that's the feasible plan they're looking at, then we should look at it. If we need to look definitely at costs, and I kind of agree with Christine that maybe there should be, where there's, while we may have federal, municipal, and provincial funds combined to create whatever detour or rerouting of that truck traffic, maybe there should be some contribution by corporations as well who are using that tunnel, if that's what we build. The other thing, though, that's really important is to look at wherever that truck tunnel comes out to connect trucks to the 417 and make sure that whatever negative consequences that has on the neighborhood are studied carefully, and that the residents of the neighborhood have a say in meaningful consultations about those effects. I know, speaking to people about the combined sewer storage facility at Stanley Park, that residents are very, very upset with the so-called consultations that went on, and that those consultations, what I was given to understand, were held in areas of the city that were not the neighborhood of Stanley Park, and that people were not, residents who were well-informed and ready to speak on their behalf, were not informed of the details of the consultations. I know that a similar thing happened around the closing of Rideau High School. So if we're going to talk about consultations have to be proposed in good faith, and the residents of Overbrook, who will be affected if we bring that tunnel out at Coventry, need to, another sort of underserved and vulnerable neighborhood, need to have a fair chance to talk about the effects on their neighborhood and make sure that the city and the governments and corporations are going to put into place mitigations. Thank you.
Thank you.
Merci. We all agree this is a serious issue and it's been there for 40 years. We all agree we have to find a solution, and we've put many solutions on the table and chose not to take those forward. Currently, we have a long-term solution that is on the table, and I believe we need to maybe study it a bit further with the truck tunnel and go forward with the environmental assessment to see if this is a feasible solution. Let's remember, though, this is a long-term solution, a $2 billion solution, if we go forward with it. So in the short term, I propose we look at that long-term solution to go forward with the environmental assessment. In the short term, if I'm elected on Monday, I want to sit with the City of Ottawa, the province, and local stakeholders, and really look at what we can do in the short term to put regulations and hopefully reduce the amount of trucks during the day, or maybe find another way to make sure that we have safer King Edward. Because I was canvassing yesterday and I saw families that are really, really bothered by this, and they want to move, but they're not going to be able to move at this time because their house won't sell. It's really a big, big issue. And there's also La Nouvelle Seine and other businesses that really want to thrive, and we need to get to a solution for King Edward. So I'm committed to work with my local elected officials and also the provincial and other stakeholders that will want to find short-term solution while we work on a longer-term one. Thank you very much.
I don't have an enormous amount to add to what's been said. I mean, I've lived in the neighborhood. I've seen firsthand not only the public safety risk that's posed by enormous 16-wheeler trucks rolling down what should be a main street of our city, but also, relevant to this forum is also the environmental impact of that. Because if you're a resident or you're visiting the area, you're having an enormous amount of truck exhaust, noise pollution, that's actually a really important point. I had someone reach out to me specifically on the question of the noise pollution. I'm doing it right. It's okay, it's all good. Having said all that, this is an issue that has plagued our community for a really long time, and unfortunately, it's also an issue that has tended to pit one part of the riding against another part of the riding. It's an issue that has been studied to death, and proposals have been put forth and not pursued. So I do think it's going to take real political leadership at this point to have this issue finally, move forward to a concrete plan. I think because we have a proposal on the table, it's one that we need to really actively pursue. We need this environmental assessment to get done. We can't just coming up with proposal after proposal. But I could not agree more with Neera's point regarding the importance of taking into account the impacts of an infrastructure project like this, not only at the construction stage, but also upon completion on affected communities. What we can't have is moving a problem from one neighborhood and putting it into another. And so that would be, really critical for me to ensure not only consultation, but also that the needs of the communities are actually being heard and acted upon.
Thank you. And I've got everybody, right? Good. So the next question. Various governments and parties in Canada are advocating the expansion of the oil sector while simultaneously professing a commitment to reducing greenhouse gas emissions and honoring our international climate change commitments. Isn't it contradictory for Canada to be working to expand fossil fuel production while trying to gradually phase out fossil fuels? Christina, you're up first.
It sure is a contradiction. Like I said before, definitely we're going into renewable. We've been doing it forever now, really. But we really need to everyone accept it. The renewable energy, the fact that Trump is now investing in petrochemicals and coal, getting rid of the Environmental Protection Agency, Canada has to leave that behind. We have to go into the future, progress all of us, like, leave these petrochemicals alone. Leave them in the ground. We don't need them anymore. We have electric vehicles. We have flying taxis in Dubai. We have, you know, like, future. Let's think future. Let's think forward and progression. And not no longer giving money, our tax pay, our money, right, to these outdated industries, and we can't have that anymore. And if there's these corporations, if they're entwined in our government, I mean, we have to get that out too. And that's why I think, like, as an independent, I'll be able to try to find ways to make the government more transparent and to really progress us is really what I want to say. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. I think there's a contradiction. There's a contradiction when you say you're going to support innovative, clean, green technologies of the future, and then you approve two pipelines to the West Coast. Yes, there's a contradiction when you're rethinking Kinder Morgan. Yes, that's a contradiction. We need to be moving. Greens believe very firmly that we need to be moving towards a post-carbon economy. We need to be investing in renewables more ambitiously and boldly than we are, solar, wind, geothermal, and others. We need to be taxing fossil fuels at source, coal definitely, oil and gas, and putting a limit on how much nuclear expansion we're doing. And we need to be moving towards a post-carbon economy. Other countries in the world are doing it. China's invested $84 billion in solar and other renewable technologies. If and when we ever get our pipelines out to the West Coast, they're not going to want our oil anyway because they're leapfrogging over us. They're seeing the future far better than we are. Shell pulled out of the tar sands very recently. Look where the money's going. We don't have to even make moral, ecological arguments about why a post-carbon economy is where we need to go for the climate and for humans and all planetary life. We just have to look at where the money's going because corporations who are seeing the future are pulling their money out of fossil fuels. Thank you.
I believe in Canada we need to go towards not using any fossil fuels, but it will take some time. And I believe that Canada has been a leader, especially with the Paris Climate Agreement, to start and show how we want to make sure our energy is cleaner and also start pricing carbon. I think that we're taking that leadership, we're moving forward, we're taking the necessary examination to make sure that if we do have a pipeline, it's secure, it's a balanced and evidence-based approach. We did cancel one, and we are not taking them all. The Liberal government did not take one of them because it was not safe, secure, and a good approach. For Energy East, it'll be the same. We will be examining, like I said earlier, with the National Board, the fact that we're examining if it's a good one or not. So I think that the Liberal government is really moving. We want to make sure that we have cleaner energy and make sure that also our children are in a safe place in the future. Thank you.
Well, I mean, first of all, when you start a process of consultation regarding the National Energy Board, and in that consultative process, you put three of the five panelists as industry-related or pro-pipeline lobbyists, I'm not sure that we can have an enormous amount of confidence in what the outcome of that process is going to be. I don't see how we can justify expansions that increase our emissions until we can see a credible plan for the future. I mean, the government talks a lot about how the energy and the environment and the economy go hand in hand, and then every once in a while they say innovation. And they think that's a plan for the future of our environment. It's not acceptable. I don't see how we as the public can even expect to be in a position to assess the reasonableness of expansions and pipeline approvals without actually seeing how that fits into some kind of a concrete targeted plan to transform our energy economy and our economy more generally. So I don't think this government, quite frankly, knows what it's doing on this issue. Of course it's a contradiction to say you want to reduce your emissions and then at the same time approve projects that are going to significantly increase emissions. I mean, that doesn't make sense. It could make sense if it was part of a long-term plan that was thought out, but just throwing out the word innovation from time to time and thinking that that's enough to satisfy Canadians that this government has a plan to reduce emissions beyond simply tinkering with the current status quo, I just don't see it. I think it's a contradiction, and I think, frankly, the government has a lot of answering to do. Just saying they signed the Paris Climate Agreement, that was the baseline, that was the beginning, that's not the end. And then to cut $1.25 billion over the next 2 years in the resources needed to actually implement the Paris Accord, once again, doesn't make sense.
Clean energy, good. Nuclear energy, bad. Now, I believed, like everybody else, that we were burning coal and it was heating up the planet dangerously. Up until 2009, when ClimateGate came out, and I heard that the guys who produced the hockey stick graph had used a trick to hide the decline after 1998. Now, people say, hey, scientists use tricks all the time. It's a way to be elegant way to do it. I'm not worried about trick. I'm worried about hide. And these guys had to hide something from us. They hid the decline. Now, they renamed it a pause. Did you hear about the pause a little while ago? It's the pause going on now. They hid the decline, but they renamed it a pause. So they have a real problem now in that for the last 18 years, there's been no rise in temperature and CO2 is still spiking and they're looking stupid. But they looked stupid before that because in the Middle Ages, they had Greenland when Greenland was green. What's it look like now? If you went to Greenland now, would you call this Greenland? But they did 1,000 years ago. And how can you believe them when they tell you that this is the hottest era year in history when you know about the medieval warm period when they had grapes in England and Greenland was green? So, yeah, I believe that these guys have fudged the books, they pulled off a scam, and they diverted resources away from us helping clean up Fukushima, which is really gonna kill you. You get a piece of fallout in you, a lot more deadly than you even know once it's inside you. And we've been bathed in it since then. And we've been fighting stopping climate from changing. Can you imagine how stupid a generation who tried to stop climate from changing will look to posterity? That's us. They tricked us into fighting to try to stop our climate from changing.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. Thank you all. Moving right along, the next question is, the last government weakened Canada's environmental procedures, including the Navigable Waters Protection Act. Water is essential for life. Are you in favor of restoring the Navigable Waters Protection Act? And what else would you do to protect water resources? Neera.
Our answer is yes, from the Green Party's perspective. And I just want to read something from the Council of Canadians, which I've also been a member of, and which is consistent with our position as a party. We need a water commons framework. A water commons framework treats water as a common good that is shared by everyone as the responsibility of all. Like our clean air, like our healthy soil, our water is under the shared stewardship of us all on the planet. Because water is essential for human life, it must be governed by principles that allow for reasonable use, equal distribution, and responsible treatment in order to preserve water for nature and future generations. I'm proud to say that the Green Party, under the leadership of Mike Schreiner provincially, who doesn't even have a seat, the Greens don't have a seat provincially, but Mike Schreiner was a leader in the fight against Nestle to privatize more water, billions of liters of water at Grassy Narrows. Whether you elect the Greens or not, we believe what we're standing for, we believe what we say, and we're walking our talk, and we will continue to work for holding water, clean air, healthy soil, healthy food, all the common, the things we hold together as common public goods, common public trust, and protect them from privatization and, well, from privatization and desecration, really, for the interests of a few. And that's our position. And whatever frameworks we need to put in place, environmental regulations, meaningful environmental reviews, we support them. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. I'll tell you that I'm not familiar with the agreement because, honestly, it's the first time I hear about it tonight, but I think it's just clear common sense. We have to protect our waterways. I've been hearing in the news last week, and you probably all heard about it, about the Great Lakes, how President Trump wants to take the money out to protect our Great Lakes. Well, I think that's where Canada can come in and really take a role in leadership, because we need to protect our navigable waters and we need to protect our Great Lakes. So for me, not knowing exactly what the act is, I just think it's common sense and I will research it, but I just want to convey the fact that I believe we have to protect our waters. Thank you.
Well, when Stephen Harper,
sorry, Emily, I think it's off the
Guys, you know, when Stephen Harper removed protection from so many of our lakes and rivers, it's okay, we're good here. And at the same time did the most Stephen Harper-ish thing ever, which was actually renamed the Navigable Waters Act to the Navigation Protection Act. Like, took out the word water, like we would forget that it had ever been about water. I think was, they just love doing that, right? Naming their bills kind of the opposite of what they really were. Anyway, so, but, you know, now, under the current legislation, only 1% of our lakes and rivers are, in fact, protected under this legislation. And unfortunately, recently, when the Standing Committee on Transport, Infrastructure, and Communities tabled its report, it did not recommend that the percentage of lakes and rivers that are covered by the legislation be increased back to where they were previously. And that's disappointing because it's not just our major waterways that require protection. I can speak from the perspective of someone who's an avid canoe tripper. I've been taking my children on canoe trips since they were 18 months old. And I want to know that I'm going to be able to get my canoe through our lakes and rivers, and that the water is going to be clean, and that there are not going to be infrastructure projects that are inhibiting my access to those navigable waterways, and that are not, you know, risking their sustainability into the future. So, I mean, yes, it was a campaign promise from the Liberals that they would reverse these amendments, and I hope that they will not follow the Standing Committee's recommendations, because 1%, it's 64 rivers, 97 lakes. That's not acceptable in a country like ours with this precious resource that we have, that we absolutely have to protect. Thank you.
Well, we have unanimity. We all agree that the waters should be protected. Not one of us is in favor of not protecting the waters. So, since we all agree, how come happiness isn't happening? Money! They got no money to pay for it. Every single one of them wants it to be better. They wish it for you. It should be. You deserve it. Doesn't mean they can deliver, but they do want it for you. And they're not lying. They're going to do their best to try, though they have no clue what to do. But they'll try, and they'll look at it seriously, with a kind heart. But budgeting is spreading around the shortage. Government borrows the principal, spends it, taxes it out with interest. So, they're always having to pay the interest to the bankers first and spread around the shortage to everybody else. That's what budgeting is all about, forever, throughout history. Interest comes first, then you pass out what's missing to everybody out there to pass out the... Mortgage means death gamble. You pass out a little bit of the death, a little here, a little there. Hopefully not too much squawking happens during budgeting days, cutting life support tickets. So again, we all want safer, cleaner waters. Nobody is against safer, cleaner waters. So what's the difference between us? Since we all want the same and all don't want not the same, who's going to come up with a way of paying for it? And that's all I've been talking about all night.
Okay, I'm not too familiar with this issue either, but I agree with John. Like, we're all obviously healthy waterways for exploring, for, you know, transporting, for drinking is a no-brainer. It would be great if clean drinking water, clean air, clean food would be rights for all of us, and that we could see our government really fighting for that. But like I said, I will have to look at this. But definitely, I mean, it sounds good.
And the next question we have then is, protecting First Nations sacred spaces are important to protect the land we all inhabit. What will you do to protect these lands, including sacred spaces within Ottawa? And how will you promote free, prior, and informed consent for Aboriginal peoples? Mona, you're up first. Did you start? No, I thought Mira went first last time. Mira, did you?
It's okay. I'm just, in my mind, I was last. Can you just repeat the question?
Sure.
The last part, please.
How will you promote free, prior, and informed consent for Aboriginal peoples?
Well, thank you very much. And I think that First Nations, Aboriginals, or Indigenous people are very important in this part of the writing. You know that in Ottawa Vanier, we have a great community, and we are working closely with the Wabano Center and with the different spaces that to make sure that they have a place to call home here in Ottawa Vanier. I'm going to talk about Water Ridge, the new development in Rockcliffe, the old air base in Rockcliffe. And I am very worried that we're not going to make sure that those spaces that we've identified to recognize the green spaces for Aboriginals aren't taken into account. And I want, and I've been discussing this with different members of the community and wanting to work with them to make sure that we do work hard in the development of the old Rockcliffe Air Base to make sure that we have the spaces and that we can work together to create that demonstration of the participation of the communities and the work together to make sure that our children can learn from the Aboriginals and what they've given to us and what they'll continue to give to us. So for me, I'll be working very hard for that project, because I've seen the plans, and I don't want it to flip-flop, because we can see that already there's construction, and I want to have access to affordable housing also in this Water Ridge project. So I will work hard with the Aboriginal community. Thank you.
Well, I think, you know, to answer this question from the vantage point of our, you know, current presence on unceded Algonquin territory, I think is a really important contextual factor to take into account here. Unfortunately, you know, this week our Prime Minister indicated that he does not accept the idea of a veto for Indigenous people. And so to say that you support free, prior, and informed consent, but you don't accept the idea of a veto, well, I mean, that is effectively what free, informed, prior consent would amount to, i.e., if you don't have those things, you don't proceed. So, you know, we are at a very critical moment in our history, I think, with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's recommendations, with a Prime Minister who I do genuinely believe is committed to renewing our relationship with Indigenous peoples, but we can't squander it by simply expressing platitudes and not following through with appropriate action that supports your claim that you want this renewed relationship. So, I mean, I think this is really critical. In our city, in particular, we should not be approving any kind of development on sacred spaces. And this may seem a little tangential, but Nira mentioned to you earlier the closure of Rideau High School. Rideau High School has within it a lodge that has been specifically built to address cultural needs of Indigenous students at that school. And to close that school and move the students, yes, they say that they're going to somehow move that with them, but taking students out of their community and having them schooled in some cases 10 kilometers away from where they live, I think is just as has just as much dissonance from this idea of a renewed relationship and reconciliation as the rejection of the idea of a veto does. And so I think we really need to be thoughtful about how we proceed from here. Thank you.
Well, thinking outside the box, if they could become financially self-sufficient with access, say, to the Bank of Canada's credit facilities, they wouldn't need your help. Okay? They wouldn't be on their backs screaming for help, begging for help, if they were self-sufficient, right? So, yeah, sure, you want to stand your back, we'll try and help you. But you want to stand up, I'd rather do that instead. So, with sufficient funding, no community would be needing our help. They should all be self-sufficient and all be able to support themselves in their endeavors. So, get rid of the loan sharking, everybody benefits is the short message. But my final point about this was that in the old days, the original natives had wampum, which was an interest-free bead worth, I don't know, an eagle feather or a horse or an hour's babysitting, you know? And now an hour's papoose babysitting. So anyway, in that way, they had their own interest-free credit system. And throughout most of history, barter was never the way they did it. You never had the right incidence of wants. I need one pig and I happen to have 50 chickens. But tabs worked. Here, I'll give you 10 chickens now and 40 chickens over the next year. And that's how most of the world worked on credits throughout history. And that is exactly how a time bank works again. Same process. So Indians had wampum, which worked that way, which goes to show that good ideas arise in all cultures, especially that one.
Okay, about Indigenous people. Well, maybe it shows my ignorance, but I like to think of everybody that we're all the same, and I don't really want to divide us into, you know, who was here first and who was, you know, Native and all this stuff. I mean, I think what's going to be good for an Indigenous person is definitely going to be good for any other person. I mean, we're all people, it's bottom line, right? I would definitely like to check out also that Rockcliffe Air Base, just because for affordable housing and things like that. But I know that they were fighting for that for a while to use that land, so that is going to be interesting to see how that works. But like I said, I mean, I feel like what's going to be good for everybody is good for everybody, and I don't really want to divide us anymore. And I'm sorry, and for everything, like, I guess, I don't know, I feel that, have we all done, and maybe a forgiveness, I don't know, is that ever, I'm sorry, like, is that just too out of the box, but maybe going forward, we could just all be together, and, I can see us doing this, we're good people, and we're cooperative, and we're forgiving, and we're accepting, and that's the way I see Canada, so. Yeah, thanks.
Well, what it were so, I teach Canadian history to newcomers, and I've been doing that for 28 years, and we haven't always dealt like good people with our Aboriginal brothers and sisters. In fact, we've dealt so poorly with them that it's a national disgrace. It's probably our number one national disgrace. And it's not good for us
to talk about leaving the past in the past, and we know that, so I'm not going to repeat all of the things that were put forward as the result of the 94 recommendations of that painful national process we went through, more painful for Aboriginal people than for us to listen, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. We need to completely, paradigmatically change the way we approach Native people in this country. Colton Bushi, again, there are things in the news that are shocking in this day and age, and those of us who are shocked shouldn't be. We have a responsibility to be informed about the history of the way we've dealt with our Aboriginal brothers and sisters and where they stand today. And I remember a few years ago with my church going to the Wabano Center for a blanket ceremony. And we have a very strong relationship trying to work with Native communities in Ottawa and around the world at the church I go to. And those people are very, very mistrustful of us, rightly so. And so, for example, I remember when I was campaigning in 2015, and they said to me, a lot of young people said, you know, we're not voting. We're not going to vote. We've been told by our elders and our leaders not to vote. We're not participating in this process. It is from the bottom up unfair. It's an unfair playing field. You know, I didn't have that much to say to that, because if I were them, I'd be distrustful too. So we need to be moving forward on a very much the nation-to-nation approach that was talked about in the last election. Free, prior, and informed consent about land or anything else has to be, that's a talk that has to be walked. And you know what? As you listen to any Native voices today on CBC or anywhere else on Aboriginal People's Television Network, it's going to cost us. We don't get off free for all the things that we enjoy at the cost of the children and the Native people who live here, have lived here, and are living here in third world conditions. Our standard of living is third by world standards. And when you apply the same standard criteria to Native people living in this country, we are 63rd. It's a shame, and we need a massively paradigmatically different way, not a little bit of tinkering in the way we do. And they hold the answers to how we should live on this planet and in this land to be able to give, bequeath it healthily to our children. They're the leaders. Thank you.
I think that this next question is a very interesting one, and that is, as a backbench MP, how would you make your mark on an environmental issue? Emily?
Well, I mean, I think in the same way that I would hope to on any issue that's important to me, but I think it's really easy to underestimate the role that, you know, in my case, where I'd be to be elected an opposition MP, can have. I mean, right now what we have is a government with a sizable majority that it's, I think, becoming increasingly comfortable with. And so I think it's as much about the quality of advocacy that you bring forward, the quality of the argument, the case that you make that's based on real evidence and data, and not as a platitude, but as a reality. And I think actually what this government needs right now is a strong progressive opposition. To really do whatever is possible to keep it on track, because I think we've seen, you know, most notably recently with the abandonment of the electoral reform promise, but relatedly, as I said, you know, the promise not to approve pipelines without a new process in place, a process which the Prime Minister himself repeatedly described as inadequate, and then turned around and approved pipelines with exactly that process. So, I mean, I believe that a backbench MP can have an enormous amount of power if that person has the courage and the capacity to stand up, regardless of whether they are part of the party that is in government or in opposition, to stand up for the values that are important to their constituents, their own values, and I think, in fact, you can have an enormous impact in a role like that.
Well, I think I would have the most impact on the people who think that this is catastrophic. How can you not want to take precautions when such terrible things could happen if the Martians really do invade next year? Hey, the same way I can make fun of the guy who's saying the Martians might invade, we gotta protect. And the guys who say it ain't the sun, it's our CO2, we gotta protect. Is simply say, bet you $100 next year's colder. And when they back down, who's most confident? I've been making people back down from a bet on next year being colder since 2009, okay? Everybody wants to shoot their mouth off about this is hot, 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 and I just gotta say, bet you next year it stops, and suddenly they don't wanna bet no more. You cannot argue with these religious believers. They continue to be fooled by the trick to hide the decline because there's a mantra that says 97% scientists, 97% scientists. Hey, you got the 1% here, real scientists, saying, you forgot about medieval warm period, slows. So the slow politicians, they still tricked. The quickie, I ain't tricked. I found out they lied to me, that's enough. And I put the boots to them with the bet on the future, and you can do the same to every warmista out there. Just offer them a bet on next year and watch them turn tail and run away. They'll tell you it's the hottest years and it's gonna get warmer, but they won't bet on it. I know, I put them to the test. So yeah, get me into parliament, I'll make fun of the slows who think that it's getting hotter.
So you would've lost your bet.
Oh yeah. Yeah, yeah, the great Canadian gambler is going to lose my bet. Google for me.
Okay, what's the question? I'm confused after every...
As a backbench MP, how would you make your mark on an environmental issue?
Wow. Okay. How would I make my mark as a backbencher for the environment? I've been a house cleaner for about 5 years. I have my own company. I definitely understand how your environment like affects pretty much everything. So I definitely stand up when it came to like, hey, are we gonna do a pipeline? I'd be like, no. Hey, are we going to, you know, anything other shady, creepy stuff? I would just say no, like, oh my gosh. I would also support, like I said, renewable energies, carbon taxes, corporate accountability. One thing that I would really like, coming from like the cleaning industry, would be home and personal cleaning product labels and regulations. I don't know if you guys know, but this is all poison that we're spreading in our houses. Just wanted to let you know. And we don't know because the chemicals are not on the cleaning product. So I would like to, as a backbencher, if I could change anything, it would be that. Just let us know what we're bringing into our home so we can make like our own choices on that. Get companies to put all the poisons and everything to be open and to let us have the right decision for our own families.
As a backbench MP, it's possible to have no effect at all or to have a very strong effect. Elizabeth May is an MP who has a very strong effect, and she's a role model for almost everybody who's working in the Green Party now. She doesn't give up. She does her homework. She's courageous. She's bold. She's not afraid to stand up as the lone voice in the wilderness often, speaking out on behalf of common good, common sense, sustainability, things that often she's standing on her own. So that's one thing, is those personal qualities, which I have. Is I would persist, I would not give up, I would do my homework, I would make sure I've got the evidence, I would make sure I've done my research properly. But also, I think whether you're in government or not, working with the myriad of citizens groups and NGOs that are doing good work in this area is very important. And we need to form strategic alliances with all of those people. So if I'm working on climate and pipelines, I would say Ecology Ottawa, which I attend many of their events and I'm allied with them. Citizens Climate Lobby Canada. If we're talking about Water Council of Canadians and CUPE and all of the Ottawa River Keepers, the many people who are brought to our church this week for our Lenten series on water, including many Aboriginal leaders. So making alliances on electoral reform, working with Fair Vote and Lead Now and other citizens groups. Our issues are too great to leave to elected politicians. As much as I'm here campaigning to become one of them. I believe that as Canadians, we need to work together with NGOs and citizens groups, organized labor groups all across the country, because our job is to make this country the country we want in the 21st century together, not to vote every 4 years and then go to sleep or go to the cottage. And so working with our NGOs and citizens groups, forming those alliances so that as a backbench MP, I can bring those voices to the table in the House is what I would do. We are much stronger together. I'm no local hero. I would help to bring all of those voices into the House with all of the work, advocacy, and research that they bring to the table. Thank you.
I want to be your Member of Parliament, and first and foremost, I want to represent the people of Ottawa Vanier, and we have a lot of work to do for Ottawa Vanier. I've been talking and canvassing for the past 4 months, and I've been hearing how we have needs and we need to get our fair share here in Ottawa Vanier. Let me give you a couple of examples. The Liberal government has decided to invest in affordable housing. Do you know that in Ottawa Vanier, we have a major issue in affordable housing and making sure that people have access to a safe and secure home? I want to work on this to make sure that Ottawa Vanier gets its fair share. We also have to continue the investments in our LRT. We're working very hard on this project, and I want to be part of the work to make sure that we have access to public transit and make sure that we also have access to subsidies for a local business to create jobs. This will help our environment. If I have the opportunity to be your Member of Parliament, I want to work with the local community organizations, the local businesses, and together with the other elected officials, identify the priorities to make sure that Ottawa Vanier is on the map. And I will work with you and all of the organizations to make sure our priorities are met. I hope I will be able to have your support on April 3rd so we can make Ottawa Vanier better. Thank you.
All right. And this is going to be the last question that we've got from the floor before everybody up here has a chance to make their closing remarks. So this last question is, with $120 million earmarked for electric vehicle charging infrastructure in the 2017 federal budget, can we expect a national policy governing the use of these funds or a national resource center supporting global levels of government? What else would you propose? John, you're up first.
All right. You know how PayPal works? Some of you, the younger ones, PayPal. Imagine you could, like PayPal, log on to the Bank of Canada's computer, open an account, and instead of pledging your Visa card, you pledge 1,000 hours of labor. Not a bad idea. Now you cut checks, Bank of Canada new chips, to pay all your interest-bearing debts, student loans, mortgages, credit cards below. You get one big number at the Sugar Daddy Bank, and after that, all your payments go against principal. That's a deal. So, use your Bank of Canada account to convert your interest-bearing debts to interest-free debts. So the guy who built your house gets paid, but the banker stops getting interest. The guy who made your shoes gets paid, but the guy who charged them interest doesn't. So basically, get everybody their interest-free bank account, and that allows everybody to become economically secure. And I don't have to help anybody anymore. It's the name of the game now to try and get positive. And most babies are going to come into the world and go negative, 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 whether daddy's a drunk or a gambler, a few operations. And then they're going to go positive over the lifetimes and hopefully crack zero and go positive even more. And then when they die, they open it up and they potlatch and they divvy out the positives. And if you died in the negatives with the retards and the slows and the sick, okay, you didn't try very hard or you were sick.
Sit down.
And we all chip in a couple of pennies.
Finish nine.
So that's the world of the future, where whether your daddy is rich or not has no effect on your access to life support with a Bank of Canada interest-free account online. Oh, Greece is talking about it, Switzerland's talking about it, Britain's talking about it, Russia's talking about online national banking. Are they going to do it first when I was proposing it 37 years ago here?
So again, the question has to do with electric vehicle charging infrastructure.
Whether we can expect a national policy governing the use of the funds that have been earmarked in this year's federal budget, or what other elements that you would propose with regards to electrical vehicle charging. Christina.
Okay, electric vehicle charging. We should have one on every second corner.
I would
hear.
Pay for it.
Thanks. Yeah, definitely. This is the way of the future, electric vehicles. If you guys check out, like, even buying a Tesla, this $100,000 car ends up being cheaper, you know, than a Honda Civic somehow. Just paying with the electricity and everything, it's only about, I think, $1 per day for an electric vehicle in your house. So it's really economical as well as great for the environment. So I would love to see supercharging stations, not just regular ones, but definitely supercharging, and as well on all our highways too, right? So that we can take them all across Canada and drive the EVs across Canada. Yes, and also, I didn't check in the budget, but remember how we were getting if you get a bonus if you went to go purchase an EV? I really hope that that's still in the budget, and I'm actually going to check on that. That would be great.
Okay. Yeah, the Green Party supports clean energy, and so any funds that are transferred down to provinces or municipalities for electric vehicle charging infrastructure need to be under the auspices of a national policy. Just as we want a national climate plan, we need a national accountable environmental review for pipelines, and we need a national policy on energy and transportation, clean transportation, under which specific things like an electric vehicle charging infrastructure would be outlined, how that money's to be used, and a transparent, accountable process so that municipalities and provinces have to report back to the federal government about where those funds were used, how they were used to support electric vehicles. And the money for this, John, just to address this thing about the money, is that if we tax our carbon, as the Green Party proposes, tax our carbon polluters at source, we will pull in billions of dollars that we can reinvest in renewable technologies, in a guaranteed livable income, and in a lot of other things that Canadians need more than coal and polluting dilbit pipelines. Thank you.
I think this is a great question, because honestly, I received that conversation at doors during the campaign. I thought maybe one or twice, no, like at least 10 residents of Ottawa Vanier had really wanting us to move forward with electric cars and possibly use other forms of the ones that we have right now to make sure that we move forward and have clean energy. So I think we really need to examine this issue of having a national policy and see how we can move forward to make sure that not only this budget, but the next ones, we continue to encourage the use of electric cars, because we have experts here in our riding, and I will take the time to go and meet them again, so we can examine closely how we can get a national policy or other measures to encourage people to use electric cars. Thank you.
It costs $10,000 to $13,000 to convert any car right now.
Well, I mean, I was pleased to see the budget providing some money earmarked for electric vehicle charging infrastructure. I think, you know, it's a pretty obvious proposition that they're not going to be proliferating in our community until such time that there's an appropriate infrastructure in place that would allow people to reasonably use electric cars. I think it's really important that we ensure that when we make investments like this, especially as we're entering into a really, I think, new terrain, that there be a policy infrastructure in place, but I think also when it comes to early expenditures like this, that we ensure that there's appropriate accountability in place when it comes to the disbursements of this money. I mean, with what we saw this week with Bombardier, for example, I think we just want to make sure that we're making smart investments and that we're ensuring that they're actually advancing this really important initiative. So it's absolutely something that I support in terms of, you know, this doesn't fall within my personal area of direct expertise. What kind of policy framework? I would be prepared to leave that to the experts, so certainly to engage with them. But I think this is a step in the right direction, and we have a lot of work to do, though, before we're going to find ourselves, you know, $120 million is not going to go that far in terms of developing the scale of infrastructure that's needed, but hopefully, you know, private sector actors will want to jump in as well, and we can, you know, hopefully one day plan to see electric charging stations replace the gas stations that we have currently.
I want to thank everybody in the audience for the questions that you contributed. We did our best to sort of bring them together and have the kind of the kinds of questions that we were hearing most often brought forward to our candidates. And of course, thanks to the candidates for the answers you've provided. You will each now have 3 minutes to offer your closing remarks. And we will start with Christina.
Okay, poverty, disease, consumerism, pollution, and violence. We see it all over the mainstream and deep web media. We see it on our streets, we see it in our homes. The whole world is pleading for a change. Like I said, if I had to triage the world's problems, I would get the environment to the ICU stat. The issues of the environment are massive, and it's hard to pinpoint where to start. I believe that the best place to start is at home. I've always been a cleaner of my tribe. I clean at friends' places, like social gatherings, you know, whenever I'm out for charity and also in my own home. And like I said, I clean for a living. So the past 5 years, I've had a house cleaning company. And from the very beginning, we realized that house cleaning was more than just a service-based business. That I actually believe that it can be a catalyst for individual and global growth. Like from dirty minds, getting clean, to even Jesus washing his disciples' feet, there are many cultural references to cleaning. It's weaved into every aspect of our life. No matter what your social economic label may be, every human is connected by the survival need to breathe clean air, drink clean water, eat clean food, sleep safely, and we all produce waste. A clean environment is vital to the health of the individual and for all of us as a species. The World Health Organization averages the yearly loss of 12.6 million people due to unhealthy home and work environment. And that number doesn't even include the masses of people who have died from environmental catastrophes. 200 million people are expected to be forced from their homes as climate refugees in the next few decades. Money, that's another thing. It's an extremely important concept in our society. Some say it's the root of all evils. Others say it revolves the earth. One thing is for certain, there is a deficit in our economy. So how does a dirty house affect the environment and the economy? Well, the answer is actually in the root word of economy. I don't know if you know, but it's actually Greek for home management. So knowing how much the economy impacts the whole world, we must hold home management up to that same value. If we continue to neglect our homes, our economy and the environment will continue to depreciate. Thankfully, we have the resources to rebuild and strengthen the foundations of our economy today. Individually, we can change our lifestyle, live with less waste, eat cleaner, use safe personal and household cleaning products, grow and can our own food, create our own products, generate wind and solar energy. You make a difference by striving to live smarter, healthier, and stronger. A good time? Okay. No, I'm done. Okay. Thanks.
Really?
The Green Party has the most long-term comprehensive plan for a sustainable, healthy, peaceful planet, because philosophically it's based from the bottom up on an understanding that we're all connected. We're connected to each other, the water, the land, the air, the political decisions we make for the economy, they're all connected. So you can't tinker with one little piece of it and not expect that it's going to have an effect on the rest. We call that, I think, the butterfly effect. There are lots of other words for it. Because we're all connected, we need to work together and we need to see the connections and connect the dots. And when we make decisions in one silo without looking at the effects it has in some other part of the planet or some other part of our country, we're in trouble. I don't agree with, as much as I respect Maud, I don't agree with representing Ottawa Vanier and talking repeatedly about our fair share. There is enough for everybody. There is enough to go around for everybody. And we don't need to be living in this scarcity mentality where we're all worried that we're not going to get our fair share. And let's put the sewer treatment plant somewhere else, somebody else's backyard, and let's stick the 417 truck tunnel somewhere else and not make it our problem. There's enough to go around if we distribute it evenly and equitably and fairly. And if everybody has a voice at the table, and if we have proportional representation, so people's positions, all positions can be represented and have a voice when we make decisions, whether in the House or at school board, school closing decision making, or where we're putting sewer tunnels. We need to have every voice represented effectively and meaningfully at the table. Not the same old voices, whether they're corporate voices or the have voices or the old stock voices, as Stephen Harper calls them. I just want to close with some of the words of our leader, Elizabeth May, like the civil rights movement of the 1960s. The climate crisis is the defining issue of our time. We're all in this together. We can't stay within the narrow confines of political games and partisan politicking and game playing and that prevent us from acting meaningfully. We can't throw around lightly words like evidence-based and consultation, the way we've devalued words like racist and other things so they mean nothing anymore. We have to use those words carefully and meaningfully and act on them. And when we have consultations, we have to make sure every voice gets heard, whether it's speaking in English or French or Cree or Ojibwe or Spanish or Arabic. We need to have walk the talk and fulfill the promise of a really, truly inclusive country where we're building it together. Citizens and elected officials all together, because we are in this together, and the challenges that face us are not, they're too large for the structures and processes of our elected officials. As fair as our processes are, and with the short-sighted sometimes ways that our processes work, we need all to be involved and we all need to be at the table. Thank you.
Wow, what a great turnout tonight. And je veux vous remercier tous d'avoir été ici avec nous ce soir. Thank you to the organizers who have been so kind to organize this event. It was great. Thank you very much. I know on election night 2015, none of us expected to be back in by-election so soon. Ottawa Vanier is my home and where I've chosen to raise my young family. Ottawa Vanier est l'endroit où j'ai travaillé pendant les 20 dernières années pour dialoguer avec mes voisins et appuyer nos entreprises, nos institutions communautaires et publiques. But most importantly, by being here, I have heard and intrinsically understand the challenges that face our riding. I understand they are as dynamic and diverse as the opportunities that our communities offer. Our riding's challenges require real leadership that will work tirelessly to find solutions. Être favorable à l'environnement signifie trouver une approche équilibrée qui respecte les opinions des experts et balancer les besoins de tous les Canadiennes et Canadiens, tout en aidant les pays en développement à s'adapter à notre climat changeant. Cela signifie investir dans des entreprises qui produisent et fournissent des produits innovants et écologiques. This government has boldly shown being pro-environment does not simply mean opposing pipelines. It means investing in new urban transit networks in Ottawa Vanier and across Canada that transform the way that Canadians live, move, and work, dramatically reducing our dependency on carbon. Our Prime Minister and his team have begun to address the challenges that affect our environment and our economy. our Minister of the Environment and Climate Change, went to Paris and negotiated the first truly global climate change agreement. Our finance minister has presented a strong innovation agenda rewarding businesses. I want to represent you and your voices in Parliament and ensure that Ottawa Vanier gets its fair share. Le 3 avril, le choix est clair. Votez pour un premier ministre et une candidate dévouée qui s'engage à travailler fort pour la classe moyenne et ceux qui travaillent fort pour en devenir. I would be honored if I could count on your support on April 3rd. Je vous remercie. Thank you very much.
Merci à vous tous d'être venus ici ce soir et merci surtout à tous ceux qui ont organisé ce débat. There can be no doubt that we are living in...
Switch mics, that one went out.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so, as I was saying previously, there can be no doubt that we're in complicated political times. Between Donald Trump and the Trump wannabes vying for the leadership of the Conservative Party, the pressures on our Prime Minister are, to quote Trump himself, tremendous. They're huge. If we don't strengthen the progressive opposition, our government will not have the backup that it clearly needs to face these enormous pressures that want to take us backwards. And not only on environmental issues. Si nous ne renforçons pas l'opposition progressiste, le gouvernement aura tout le loisir de continuer à briser ses promesses pour bâtir un pays plus progressiste. Ottawa Vanier a besoin d'une députée qui va se tenir debout à défendre les intérêts de notre communauté, autant ici qu'au Parlement. We need an MP who will work locally with the community and who has the ability to defend our interests at the national level. I grew up in a family that has a strong history of public service. It's part of who I am. My time as a public prosecutor has prepared me well to get to the heart of a problem, build consensus, and broker real solutions. The Liberals may have broken their promise to make every vote count, but next Monday, you can make your vote count if you vote for me. I hope you'll do that, and I promise I won't let you down. Votez pour moi, je promets de ne pas vous laisser tomber. Merci et bonsoir.
I love being the iconoclast and shattering cherished myths. Like I shattered those people who say these are the hottest times ever. Gee, you forgot about the Middle Ages, duh. And it goes in one ear and out the other. My iconoclasm shattering his cherished myth about global warming. When I looked at the Middle Ages, when it was called Greenland, I said, you gotta be a dunce to believe it's still warmer now. Now, what about vaccinations? You're pumping your kids full of many combinations of safe vaccines without testing the combinations. 26 vaccines in the first year of a kid in the United States. Only 16 million combinations to test. But you know all about combinations. Okay, by the way, nice to see you go. The snows and can't spin with us. And the last one is, of course, marijuana. Nobody talked about marijuana tonight. And with the Fukushima cancers that are coming, you're going to need marijuana. And you're not going to have access to it during the time it's on you. So, hey, excuse me, sir, you want to stand up here and face the camera and tell us why you're interrupting this? Is this another organizer? Who is this guy over here? Want to interrupt me? You want to come and talk? It's enough, it's enough. I'm the last speaker. You can shut me down and shut me down, right? Sweetie, I got this guy, I got this guy. You want me to stay on point. Anyway, I think we'll leave it on that issue. This guy had the last word, this guy had the second last word, and you missed my last word. Post the video on YouTube.
The Ottawa Vanier candidate debate on the environment. Merci à tous et toutes qui sont venus ce soir pour être avec nous. Again, thank you, Ottawa, Citizens for Public Justice, and the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Ottawa for organizing us. There are information about all these organizations on the table, so please stop by in the area. Thank you, Melanie.